Hey, welcome back to the Hotel Orloff here in Rural Retreat, Virginia. Oh, look at this. We're watching on Right Side Broadcasting. President Trump is visiting an agricultural fraternity up in Des Moines. He's about to go to a big football game. Well, let's get the sound on. This is how I'm spending my Saturday afternoon, and we're going to be looking at some books here in a moment. Turn on the stereo.
How you doing, President Trump?
I'm doing good.
What do you think about this?
This is some turnout. I guess the youth likes Trump, but we love Iowa. We just left South Dakota last night. It was an amazing evening. We got a wonderful endorsement, as you know, from the governor, and we're here, and this reception's been incredible. Really
incredible. A lot of your students are talking about the cost of living, gas, and, of course, what Biden did with oil.
Gasoline's going up. Your heating's going up, everything. We're going to bring it all the way down where I had it. We're gonna do a little bit of drilling, I can tell you that right away. But no, gasoline's going way up, way, way up. Thank you, everybody.
We'll let you walk around here. I know you're a busy man.
Yeah, you take care of yourself, okay?
Sure, thank you very much.
All right, well, price of comic books is going up, too.
They love you, Mr.
Let's see. I was just watching Jambo Comics' new video. And he was showing some comics he's taking to a convention soon, and I saw he had Marvel feature number one from 1971 with the first appearance of the Defenders, and I said, boy, I sure would like that book. And I looked it up, and it's a pretty pricey book on mycomicshop.com. I said, I may have to make payments on that, but hopefully he'll see my message, because I've always wanted that book. Let me turn the sound up. Hey, that was a great show Wednesday night. That was a lot of fun to have Mike McCarthy visit. It was awkward because I only had six people could be on StreamYard at the same time, and I was wanting Mike to come in, but then so luckily some other, like Jambo mentioned, I've got to go, I got some paperwork to do, so that. Anyway, it was weird. It's like Sophie's Choice trying to, it's like, I can't fit all these people in. But anyway, Micah, Graphic Man, is taking the show back over on Wednesday the 13th. He's back. I think I did it for five, maybe 6 weeks while he was recovering. But luckily, he's back to do the show right. I was talking about this CD to Mike McCarthy the other night, and it's Television Music by Jack Marshall. It also has two CDs in it. It also has music from the Deputy Wagon Train and the Virginian. So the first disc is all the Munsters. It's like the actual soundtrack music, never released in 57 years, you know, since it first premiered on television. Well, yesterday was Star Trek Day, right? It was September 8th, 1966, that Star Trek first premiered on the NBC network, so they call it Star Trek Day. And today is significant, September 9th, 9/9/99. Remember what happened in 1999, September 9th, 1999? The moon broke away from the Earth's orbit and went shooting off into space with a whole colony of humans on it. You don't remember that? Well, anyway, they call it Breakaway Day. And I remember that the first episode of the TV show Space 1999, it started in September of 75. And I was all excited because I was all into Star Trek, and they said, this is going to be the new Star Trek. And it had wonderful special effects, but it was trying to be a little bit more like 2001, A Space Odyssey, with the understated acting. You know, Barbara Bain would, yes, what is it? It's just, it's like, it looks like alien. They were almost like more lifeless than the puppets had been in the previous Gerry Anderson TV series. But I mean, I love Space 1999. It just wasn't a new Star Trek where the people had more personality, you know, the crew, they were all well-rounded and interesting people. In the second season, they tried to make it a little different, and people didn't like that. But anyway, Space 1999 has a place in my heart, and I remember the first episode was called Breakaway because I was so excited about Space 1999. I got the paperback book that adapted the first two episodes, whatever, and before the series even premiered, I was like already getting the merchandise before it came on because I'd been reading about it, you know. So Space 1999, yesterday was the day to honor Star Trek, today's the day to honor Space 1999. Of course, Monday is 9/11, so there was, you know, the imaginary disaster on September 9th, but there was the real thing that happened on the 11th. And in early October next month, they're going to have this giant alert that's going to be nationwide on every phone, everything, like what would happen if they're going to test how they would do it if there was some huge horrific disaster. And so conspiracy people are all a buzz about that, you know. It's like, is there going to be something real happening right after? But anyway, I won one of the prizes on Captain Strangelove's 14th anniversary celebration the other week, and I got my prize package in, and I got this Batman figure. He's a multiverse figure. He's not the Batman that you might know, but a little bit different. It's from Todd McFarlane, or is it Farlane? McFarlane? The Spawn guy. Well, it's having a senior moment, trying to remember, is it Todd McFarlane or Farlane? I never was a huge fan of Spawn. I mean, I tried to get into it in the 90s. It seemed like the next big thing, but it just didn't. And then, you know, the movie came out, and it, you know, then you lose even more enthusiasm about it. But and by the time he started taking over Spider-Man, I'd kind of, I lost interest in Spider-Man when they put him in the black suit, and I wasn't around for Venom. But this is, I guess this is some alternate variation of Batman, and it's pretty cool. There's a little grappling gun and a little batarang that are supposed to fit here, but I haven't been able to get them into. Let me see if I can do it on the air. I'm not very good with small objects. So I'm multitasking. I'm watching Trump walking around the college there as the college football game's about to start. See, you've got this grappling gun because, you know, what apparently just about every filmmaker from What's-His-Face, Zack Snyder back to all the filmmakers that have done Batman seem to think that he has guns and machine guns that come out of the Batmobile. But in the reality, Batman only used a grappling gun because he was completely anti-gun because his parents were killed by a gun. Oh, he's autographing footballs. This is cool. Look at that, ladies and gentlemen. Autographing footballs. Okay, so, the tripod's collapsing. This tripod is also courtesy of Captain Strangelove. This was an AOK, I think, last summer. And it sure had been a godsend, making my show more stable. Although, sometimes there's no way to this network is always unstable. All right, so this thing, I apparently, you know, the picture on the package, which I destroyed in order to get it out, it looks really cool when he holds this back and like he's about to throw this batarang. But how do you get it into his fingers, man? I almost feel like I've got to super glue it in. Oh, I think I got it. Does that look right? There's apparently a whole series of these Batmans, and one looks just like the vintage 70s Batman. I'd like to get that one. I guess we need to have it back like this, like he's about to hit you in the head with a batarang. Yeah, this is very well designed. He's got a great toy company. I got part of the prize was this movie that I've been wanting to see from Horror Mike. This is a movie he made when he was living in South America. It's also called Cuentos de la Bruja. I know Bruja means witch. Oh man, it's got, look at this. It's got a little card inside with a pre-code horror comic on it. And it's got some playing cards. Oh, Haunted Thrills. I wonder if somewhere out there there's a whole playing deck. I bet there is. I bet there's a way to get a whole deck. But I only have, 50 more cards to go and I'll have a whole deck. And look at this. You don't see this very often on a Blu-ray. It's hand-numbered. This being copy number 290. So I keep hearing rave reviews about this. It's all, it's kind of like a Tales from the Crypt kind of deal, and that this is a movie that Tim Burton, that's the guy, I'm sorry, Tim Burton, I was trying to think of his name, Tim Burton did use the guns. I can't think of Tim Burton's name, I don't know why. And just about every filmmaker as up to Zack Snyder. And I don't know about this new Batman movie because I only watched 10 minutes of it. The one that has the real emo-looking guy playing the guy from, what is he, the guy from the sparkly vampire, the Twilight movies playing. I've only seen a little bit of it. I meant to go back and watch the rest of it, but, you know, I tried to watch it with my wife, and it was just, she wasn't interested, and I said, well, I'll go back and watch it on my own, and that just hasn't happened. Anyway, this is like the Tales from the Crypt 1972 Amicus movie, in that it's got little features that are, man, I what's going on with my brain? I can't think of words now. It has different stories adapted from various pre-code horror comics. Not EC comics, but the other ones that are probably all public domain, unlike the EC comics. So he's taken, I'm sure he tells you, I'm almost positive he'll tell you in the credits, the issues and the issue numbers, the titles and the issue numbers of the stories that he's adapted, because he's very much a purist, and he Horror Mike loves these vintage 1950s horror comics. So I got this. I'll be watching this with my wife at some point soon. Hopefully tonight. This apparently is part of the Archie Horror line. I got this comic, Pop's Chocolate Shop of Horrors. That actually looks, I'm actually pretty hungry right now, and that's actually, I guess that's supposed to be disgusting, but it looks delicious to me. I don't know. Maybe there's something wrong with me. But there's a cheeseburger I get at the local restaurant that looks a lot like that. Let's see what this comic looks like. Because Graphic Man was saying the cover fools you because it looks great, and then the art inside doesn't look Too good. Let's see.
I look back when I was in college.
Yeah, it doesn't look like Archie comic art. It looks very much. It looks very computery. See the way the computery kind of coloring, which may be perfectly acceptable to kids today, but I don't know. That this artwork really looks like it was done by a talented 14-year-old. I mean, if this was someone that was a freshman in high school, I'd say, that's really good. But if this is a professional comic from Archie that's been around 80, since 1940, the Archie comic line, I'm sorry, I don't mean to insult you if you happen to be watching. There's several artists in here. Story by Die and Dash, story by Amy Chase, line art by Federico Sabatini, Chris Panda, Liana Congas. These are the artists that anyway, this art isn't as bad as the first story. It just, you know, do it in the Archie House style, and it'll be a lot more effective. This is some little cutesy comic strip that looks more kind of like vintage Archie. But when you do the cutesy art with the gore, it becomes far more intriguing and disturbing. Here's the Riverdale and the Sabrina TV show, which is, I guess, the audience they're going for with this. I couldn't get past the first episode of Riverdale, but my wife and I watched every episode of Sabrina, and it was, I mean, the lead that played Sabrina was very engaging, likable person, but the script, the show was just very disturbingly satanic, you know. It's like, but oh well, you know, that's the society we live in, I guess. They want to glorify that. Okay, what else? Oh, this is I guess this is the same book, but with a different cover. Well, I can tell that that's Jughead, and I assume that's Archie because he has red hair. Oh, they're replaying I gotta pause this. They're replaying last night's speech. I already recorded that last night. I got this issue of ROM Space Knight, number one, which I have two copies of it. Jambo, if you need a copy of ROM Space Knight number one, maybe I could partially trade you for that Marvel feature number one. This used to be a $100 book, but I think times have changed a little bit. Because people figure they'll never be able to get ROM because Marvel won't reprint it because it's a toy and the toy company will have to agree to let them reprint it. Well, apparently they have because there's an omnibus coming out, or maybe it's out. Okay, this is the cool, well, no, it's all cool, especially the Horror Mike movie. But the thing I was looking for the most that out of the prize was two issues of Strange Adventures that I didn't have. And this is issue number 211. And it has Captain Strangelife writing on the back. 1968, number 211. I think it says brown pages. Very good to find. $15. $15. Okay, let's take a look. Yeah, well, a lot of people put comments on the back of the board. That's something I've yet to start doing, but it seems like it makes a lot of sense to do that. No, that must not say brown pages. These aren't brown pages. Well, I mean, they're not the whitest of, no, that can't be what it said. I must have misread it. It's not gonna be a 5.0 if it has brown pages. No, this is in very good condition, I would say. What did it say on the back there? Very good to find. Yes, I agree. This is wonderful. Man, this is the greatest. I've always wanted this. Oh, it has a wonderful smell. This has that old comic smell. The greatest thing, about once or twice a year, back in the 80s, yeah, it was probably the 80s, Lone Star Comics had a warehouse, big building back behind their store, which is in a 50s little strip center. But behind there was a building, and on a Saturday, a couple times a year, they'd open that building up and have a big warehouse sale. And, ooh, this smells good. And you'd go into this, it was an air condition, and all the comics weren't bagged, and they were comics as far as you could see. And you'd be pulling up 60s Daredevil comics, whatever, you know, it's just comics they hadn't processed yet. And the smell in that barn of all of these comics being heated by the Texas sun, some of which are probably still, you know, their warehouse now, if you order from mycomicshop.com, is not that warehouse. They have a deluxe, probably like at the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark, where you can see, you know, the boxes go on forever. I think that's probably what mycomicshop.com, I haven't been in that. This is just beautiful art, of course. I wonder what that said. This isn't brown pages. So, art is by Neil Adams. Wonderful book. This is perfectly acceptable condition for me. You know, living in Texas, I'm used to pages being a little discolored because it's hot there. That can't be brown pages. Oh, well. What time is it, man? 2:30. Oh, I see why he doesn't like my lights. This type of my light seems to tear. The ones that I had didn't quite like this. What the heck is going on here, man? I don't like this. I'm going to have to put it in another bag. All right. This one is Strange Adventures 213, and look, it has a Neil Adams signature on it. So that's like the coolest part of the prize, having an autograph. Signed Neil Adams, very good plus. Chicago Comic Con, August 10th, 2012, Friday. He's got it right down to the, that's pretty cool. It's all kind of got that pedigree. It's got exactly the date when it was signed. Yeah, I don't have many signed comics. I've got a What If that's got a Frank Miller signature on the inside page. I didn't have it auto. It's just the way it came. Wonder if I have anything else autographed. Oh, I got a Big Daddy Roth to autograph an issue of Cartoons. Sorry, just admiring the wonderfulness. I'm gonna go up and put this with my other Strange Adventures probably here in a moment. Maybe I'll bring you along, because I don't remember what issues of Strange Adventures I have, but I know I don't have these two. So this was the highlight of the prize. These wonderful Neil Adams Dead Man comics in Strange Adventures. And and that Horror Mike movie, Witch Tales. I'm excited about that too. And I mean, it's all great. I have two copies of ROM, so I could maybe use that as trade with someone that doesn't have it. In fact, I was looking at them in a recent episode. You may watch, and I've got, this is a newsstand. I've got a newsstand and a comic shop one. The cover is really striking on that ROM. I always thought the toy was kind of junky. When did that come out? Late 70s? Man, I was probably about 14 when that toy came out. It just didn't look that cool to me. But in the way it's drawn in the comic, it looks a lot cooler than the way it looks in real life. Although, if I was to see that robot now, that ROM toy, I would probably be amazed by it. But at the time, it just didn't look that cool, you know? Because when I was a kid growing up, the Zeroids in the early 70s, was that late 60s, somewhere in 1970-ish? I thought they were amazing, the Zeroids. And ROM is no Zeroid. I knew the Zeroids, and Mr. You're no Zeroid. Yeah, see, the Batarang will not stay in his hand. So, I'll just... Maybe we'll just have him kind of in this pose. I'll go put him in the Batman room. In fact, let's do that right now. Before he, and I'll keep, it's, how do you guys keep these little accessories, especially these action figures that come with the five different heads and all these different hands? How do you keep from losing all the accessories? I mean, I know some people never take the toys out of the packaging, but I think that's just not my philosophy. I like to have the things out. Because I saw Toy Story 2. And I know that toys that never get taken out of the packages turn into homicidal, mentally dysfunctional entities. So that's not what I want to do to my toys. I've got to look out for their psychological... Okay. Here we are. Ladies and gentlemen, back in the monster corner. When we last were in the monster corner, we were looking at the Batmobiles, and the battery ran dead. So see that Batman there? Hold on. Am I even showing it? I can't even tell what I'm pointing at. There it is. See that thing there? I built that. I made that. I sculpted it out of Sculpey, Super Sculpey, baked it in an oven and painted it. So that's one of a kind. That's the only Batfink in existence. That is my creation. I learned about Super Sculpey from Joe Riley, who was a friend of mine, the guy that did the hypnotic eye. He taught me about Super Sculpey, how you could sculpt with it and then bake it in an oven and then paint it, you know, and... he has some hairs. See the hair sticking out? I don't know if you can see that. He's got little hairs sticking out on his chin. Those are, I think I cut them like little bristles from a toothbrush I put in there. But anyway, let's see where I should put this new Batman toy. I think over here might be a good spot. Let me set his little... gun and batarang down, and here's a pretty good Batman figure here. I don't know who made that one. I don't know what that, and this is one based on the way he looked in his first appearance. Maybe we could put him here next to the Catwoman. Okay, how do you, okay, there you go. Next to Bambi. We'll put him in front of Lon Chaney, London After Midnight. Okay, looks pretty good. All right, so he fits right in. Incredible. All right, so today my plan, now that we've looked at the present that I want, I mean the prize that I got from Captain Strangelife's broadcast, I wanted to look at some issues of the Comics Journal. So let's do that. Oh, this is another, this cell was painted by Joe Riley here. There's Joe Riley stuff everywhere. I just need to put it all together. We were talking about Joe Riley on Wednesday's show, so you'll have to, if you haven't watched it, tune in. I think you'll enjoy it. When the show was over, I stayed and talked to Mike McCarthy for like an hour at the end, because I really haven't talked with him much, you know, in like 30 years. So I was catching up with him. So hopefully you won't see it as self-indulgence and you'll be entertained by two guys talking about rock and roll culture and comic books and music. And yeah, but people liked Herbert Hoover. That wasn't his fault, the Depression. Remember what Archie and Edith always sang every week? Mister, we could use a man like Herbert Hoover again. But when the Depression started, of course, everyone, they were blaming the everything on him, and the all the homeless, the newly created homeless that were living in little shacks, and little villages of shacks, they called them Hoovervilles, right? They named them after him. That's what they always do, you know. It's all, you know, they say, well, Biden will say, Trump did a horrible job. Look how it was when he left. That's because of the pandemic. And things were going great until that was unleashed. And then he says, look at all the jobs I've grown. Well, that's because people went back to work after the pandemic, and then you made the economy so bad that people are having to take two or three jobs just to barely survive, and that creates the illusion that there's all these other jobs, but it's just the same people doing a bunch of jobs, creating the illusion that there's a lot of new jobs. But, you know, you can believe what you want to believe. Because there are people that still think Joe Biden is just amazing. But we don't talk about politics here on this channel. Let's look at the Comics Journal. This is a magazine I started getting at Lone Star Comics. Lone Star Comics was my local comic store in Arlington, Texas. It opened in the summer of 1977, the same summer that Star Wars came out. And I look in the newspaper, and there's an article about a comic book store on East Abram Street. And there's this young guy that's running it, and his name was Buddy Saunders. They're talking about how he was an ex-art teacher here locally in Arlington, Texas, and how he's opened a comic store. And I couldn't wait, I was 12, to get my parents to drive me to that store. And then after, I couldn't get them to drive me all the time, so I started walking across town to get there. And that was probably about 5 miles. I'd walk there in the summer heat and walk back, and I had a lot of fun doing that. One time, it's kind of a cool feeling to just walk across an entire city. And I'd buy 60s Thor comics and stuff, but It was safer there, like in Arlington then. It's now a crime-laden cesspool of horror, which is why we moved away from there. But yeah, this box is labeled Comics Journal. I said, but yeah. I can't, you guys keep saying so yeah, and it gets into my noggin, and I don't want to be someone that says so yeah. So knock it off, man. Talk like normal humans. Let's look at Comics Journal. The first one I bought was issue 42. And it would have amateur artists, sometimes artists that would later go on to become big stars. But the Comics Journal was very... one problem with it is it had tiny print. And that's not much of a... That's not as much of a problem when you're 12, but when you're 58, that's kind of a problem. But anyway, very well written, very... Wow, there's Dead Man. See, everything comes full circle. Gary Groth that put this magazine out was... oh, there's his name. He was... he was a very intelligent guy. And the Comics Journal, I assume it's not published anymore, would shake up the industry. It championed Jack Kirby and creators' rights and things like that. Here's that was 42. This was exciting when you're a little kid to have this magazine. And it's a fans, sort of started as a fanzine, but this is pretty slick, you know, slick paper. And you really find out all the details about what's going on in the comic industry that you wouldn't have known. There was no internet. This is how you find out all the what's going on. Like, why did Howard the Duck all of a sudden put on pants? He didn't have pants like Donald Duck. Why did he suddenly put on pants? And then later when they made that horrible movie that George Lucas produced, he had the pants on. Why did he suddenly do that? In the comic, as I recall, there was some legion of decency that was upset with Howard the Duck and made him put on pants. And I think didn't they wear bells on their head or something? Well, in reality, Disney was suing Marvel. They were threatening a lot, which is ironic because Disney now owns Marvel. But Disney was threatening a lawsuit over Howard the Duck looking too much like Donald Duck. And so... they put on pants, and I guess Disney was satisfied. Okay, it doesn't look as much like Donald Duck now. But it would give you the news, you know, what, you know, Marvel's canceling some books. And you would become a 12-year-old expert on what's going on out there. And they didn't get the thing's color quite right on the cover. I think they probably... didn't have the right inks or something, who knows. Marvel to publish heavy metal type book. So this should be some, I imagine this is about some, oh, look at this. Selling original art. I had my, it's got to be over there. Last episode, I had the magnifying glass. I'm going to need it for comics. There it is. For a Comics Journal episode, I definitely am going to need my supersonic atomic-powered magnifying glass. Oh, look at Drew. How are you doing, Miss Drew? I always call her Mr. I don't know why I do it. It makes my wife angry. She says, why do you keep misgendering our daughter? I don't know. I call all dogs. I treat all dogs like they're guys, and I treat all cats like they're girls. It's insanity, isn't it? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, excuse me while I... Okay. Oh, it has a Marv Wolfman interview. Best and worst of comics. Oh, I was wanting to look up the year. I bet it's 77. Maybe 78. I bet it's probably got to be 78. 1978, Fantagraphics, yeah. Sure, indeed. Yes, indeed. How about that? This is issue 44. Oh, and then issue 45 has Superman interview. I need to get earlier issues from maybe get on mycomicshop.com and get earlier issues, because this is a lot of fun to read. Just when you're my age, you gotta, like, I have reading glasses from the dollar store or one of these stupid things. I used to watch my mom, and my would always be reading with a magnifying glass. Now I'm her, and my dad would be reading these books about the Civil War with all these photographs, William Brady photographs, that was his name, right? And he'd always be poring over the photographs, looking at all the stuff, the guys, all the soldiers. He's looking at their equipment with a magnifying glass. Well, this is when the Superman movie came out with Christopher Reeve, which was a great movie. A little jarring in tone. I mean, it was very serious, like a biblical epic. And then they introduced Lex Luthor and his partner, played by Ned Beatty. And I didn't mind, you know, his Lex Luthor's girlfriend. You know, that's fine. But it's like, why would Lex Luthor have this idiot, Ned Beatty, as his henchman? Because it's not like he's a super powerful bodyguard, but kind of dumb. He's just dumb. Now, what I would have done that would have fixed that problem, I don't know why they decided to go campy with the villain. I don't mean to take the movie apart. I love the movie. But I would have explained that that the Ned Beatty character, Otis O'Toole or whatever, Otis Toole was the partner of Henry Lee Lucas. It's not him. What I would have done with Otis is I would have said, okay, because they're trying to steal a missile, right? Because he wants to destroy all of California and have it drop into the ocean so that the land he bought on the other side of the San Andreas Fault would now be beachfront property. Which doesn't seem like that crazy a plot now with the stuff they're doing in Hawaii and stuff. It seems like the stuff we used to see in these James Bond movies and these comic book movies and these comic book movies, these pulps, it all seems like the news today. But anyway, I would have explained that Otis is an idiot savant that's a nuclear expert that knows all about the codes and everything. But in every other respect, he's a moron, but he knows that. He's focused on that like Asperger's. He's focused. He's a mathematical genius, even smarter than Lex Luthor in that category, and that's why Lex Luthor has him. I would have done that, but, you know, no use crying over spilled milk from... how many years is that? 50 years? It's hard to believe. I remember being there the first day seeing Superman the movie. Or do they call it the motion picture? I don't know. Yes, indeed. Saw it at the Cinema 4 in Arlington, which I think is now a church. Oh, yes, indeed. Marvel hopeful about Weird World. That was a great comic. It was a Lord of the Rings imitation, but with terrific artwork. I mean, great artwork. But it wasn't... it didn't ultimately didn't last. Yeah. Yeah, this is Warren News, and that's not Red Sonja. That's a character called Gita by Frank Thorne, and he did it. This character in 1984, which was Warren's kind of magazine that was designed to be really naughty and pretty moronic. This is a nice cover. They got Will Eisner to do the cover here on the Spirit issue. Changes in the X-Men. I'm just looking for things that might be interesting to you. Here's Fred Hembeck doing a version of the front cover from when Harvey did a Spirit comic reprinting the old Spirit stories. They put out two issues, giant-sized issues, in the mid-60s, and that's all they did, but it was good while it lasted. Yeah, I remember that little Abner book. I remember asking for that for Christmas and got it. Just a fun magazine, you know. Do you see old issues of Comics Journal in your comic stores? I don't know if a lot of stores carry old issues of this. I don't know if people care. I care. Here's issue 80, Seduction of the Ignorant. Some of these essays are written very much on a college level. Column of comment by Harlan Ellison. It was in this magazine. There's a Harlan Ellison interview. I've got it in one of these issues. Or Captain Strangelove was talking about this in a recent episode where he describes Michael Fleischer, the comic book writer that did Jonah Hex and the Spectre and stuff like that. He describes him as being a little crazy. I see what it is. Oh, but anyway, and Michael Fleischer sued because he said, you're calling me crazy. Everyone in the industry reads this magazine. This was a magazine that was all around the Marvel and DC offices. It was read by the professionals. Every issue, they read it cover to cover. And, you know, if he's described as crazy, he wrote a novel also that wasn't comic book related called Chasing Harry that was apparently very extreme. And Harlan Ellison saying, this guy's just, Harlan Ellison explained, I meant it as a compliment. Just like, you just say, you see something you can't believe. You know, let's say you see Dawn of the Dead in 1978, and you say, George Romero must be out of his mind. Look at this gore. I've never seen anything like this. You don't mean like he needs to be committed. You just mean like, wow, I can't believe someone's doing something more outrageous than I do, even in my fiction, is what Harlan Ellison's saying he meant. But anyway, that's the start of all that. There's this column, The Seduction of the Ignorant. I remember reading this, and they're talking about, you know, stuff that, you know, it was in the comics in the 50s, like injury to the eyes and stuff. But it goes on, as I recall. And it's talking about how far Warren's going in 1984, just with, if you saw that for a second, I don't want to show it too much, but Warren was pushing the envelope with everything with that 1984 magazine, and it wasn't, it's like EC Comics in the 50s pushed the limit, but the writing was great. It was really sophisticated science fiction. It was great horror. It had a legitimate artistic purpose. But 1984, the art was good, but the writing was just garbage. It was just nothing but the F word, as I recall. It was just very insulting, even to my 13, whatever, however old I was. Are these even in order? Are they 46? Oh no, these aren't in order. That's issue 80 is way out of order. Okay, here's 47. I was wondering, how did 1984 show up that early on. 1984 started more when I was in high school. Here's Steve Skeets. He passed away, I think, last summer. The Death of the Superheroes. This is a cover. I think my wife's... I need to probably go in a few minutes. How long? Hopefully this episode will end soon. Yeah, they were selling back issues even then. Yeah, you see, there's a Will, the conclusion of the Will Eisner interview. This is the next issue after that one with the Will Eisner cover. Okay, that's 47. And then 49 is, got Shade the Changing Man. This artist, Fujitaki, I think he, did he later become a big deal, I think? There's Heavy Metal in Review, and it's a whole, oh, look at this. Boy, is this bringing the episode full circle. Here's, they're announcing the printing of ROM Space Knight number one. The comic I just got in the prize. What are they saying about it?
But that goes to the people, that goes to the workers, it goes to everybody. But we 28 billion. I said nobody else is gonna.
That's when the She-Hulk comic was starting. I preferred the Savage She-Hulk to the glamorous model She-Hulk later that was all self-aware when she's breaking the fourth wall. You know, I like the earlier version. Here's the issue. What number is this? It's a summer special, 1979, and it's focusing on a weird world there on the cover. Weird World, by that time they were calling it Wizards of the Shadow Realm. I guess so it would sound more like Lord of the Rings. It's got the of the in it. To give you a sense, that's the Conan issue that was coming out at the time. So I think that's in order. 47, 49. Okay. I think that I'm going to go and come back later. This is almost an hour. An hour should be good enough for you. We'll look at more Comics Journal later. If you're not interested in Comics Journal, put a comment down below and tell me this is the crummiest episode I've ever seen, and I'll show you something different. Yeah, I'm gonna head on out into the sunset for a little bit. So, turn off the lights. The party is over. I'll see you. I'll do another episode soon. I just got things to do. All right, take care, ladies and gentlemen.